Hey, good evening all, and a warm welcome to everyone for our talk. We know it's the last session for the day, and many of you are getting ready to be back home and enjoy the weekend. But we'll keep the session as much as interesting as possible. And I'm Poornima, I'm from Cognizant. I'm the engagement lead. I strategize and deliver transformation engagements for the enterprise. And he's Alfus, he's my architect. He kind of closely partners with me on the journey that I'm working on for my clients. So the topic or the today's talk is all about how do you rapidly transform .NET legacy apps into Cloud Foundry, and how do we really do it at scale, right? Because many a times we start the journey, but we just get stuck because so much that if I take insurance as an example, right, as an industry, there's so much of legacy baggage that we carry, and the moment we start and if we end up failing, it becomes like, why should I progress with the journey, right? So with that, there is a quick fire exit announcement in case of any fire. Please feel free to go to the closest fire exit and exit out of the conference room. And so we are talking about rapidly transforming legacy apps. So what it means, like, we cannot just do that, right? So we need to really know what the key drivers are that is going to drive the transformation itself. Why do we say we need to really know the drivers, given that it's a technology transformation that we are planning to do? But when we say we are going to do it at scale, what it means to the enterprise, right? So we really need to focus on three key drivers. Obvious, the business driver that will drive the transformation, the economy driver, and the technical drivers. Needless to say, the business driver is the key for any transformation that you do, because you need to deliver value to the business, right? And when we say deliver value, what it means is your technology transformation should be able to give the change or the expansion that the business is looking to deliver pretty seamlessly, right? And of course, the value proposition should be really, really not purely based on the technology or the infra cost or the aspects like that, but what it means to the end customers. So we really need to first identify that when we are talking about thousands and thousands of applications that we are going to transform. And by default, you get a good optimal savings on the infra platform operations itself, right? When you're moving in away from your static infrastructure into cloud, automatically your developers can then focus on developing things rather than really having the overhead of managing the operations part. And of course, the development cost itself is going to come down because you automatically course correct on your CI/CD pipelines and other things, and the way you deliver change to the production is going to be pretty quick and seamless as you move into the real transformation journey, right? And last but not the least, the technical uplift, that the technology uplift that you get, right? So you really get you move away from a vertical scaling to a horizontal scaling, and of course from an IaaS to a PaaS infrastructure, because of which you get self-healing, auto-monitoring of the applications that you host on the infrastructure, and of course, the immutable infrastructure. And why we say, like, we need to really look at these key drivers as a key element is, you can really strategize on your roadmap, right? We are talking about thousands of applications, and you cannot just pick an application randomly and start doing the transformation, right? We really need to categorize them. We need to really identify what are the answers for these business drivers, these three drivers, right? And then even go to the extent of really classifying them as simple, medium, and complex, the changes that you would need, whether you need to really re-platform or you need to re-architect or you need to really modernize the applications, right? And probably build a holistic roadmap that you can really baseline and start to measure your transformation journey itself, as opposed to just picking in pockets applications and then transforming them into cloud. So we have had this experience where for one of our enterprise, we tried doing it more in a very unplanned fashion, and All we could do is we were just able to make a progress of some 3-4 apps that we were pushing, we were able to push into cloud. But when it became like, okay, now we are looking to move thousands of apps, so what is the cost benefit going to be? Like, which apps should we be moving? So all those questions came in, and that's when we thought it makes sense to do an extensive discovery and scoping sessions with the enterprise, identify their imperatives, what is that they want to really achieve as their end goal, right? It can be anywhere starting from a customer experience to an infrastructure saving, right? And determine that and then go about marching into your cloud transformation journey itself. And what it takes to re-platform, right? When we say re-platform, all it means is apply your critical 12 factors, you create a cloud-ready or a cloud-friendly app, and which are the candidates that really are good for this kind of a thing, right? So it is more the batch applications, the back-end systems, and the less frequently changing apps, if we were to say, right? Like, they are pretty stable, they have a good solid code base, all it requires is they just need to be re-platformed, be cloud ready, and just be have the ability to operate on the platform. And of course, definitely cost is a big deal there, even if you do that, because the same aspect, right? Your static infrastructure is gone and you're on cloud, and that's how you go about doing it. And then on the modernized front, right? What are the candidates that really are the suitable ones for the modernized aspect? Like the heavy tech debts application, right? The applications that have really the old code base, heavy code base, and they really require a lot of dynamic scaling because they are data intense apps, and they need to be really either be re-architected so that they, for this digital era, the changes that you apply to those apps really need to go quickly out in the production and thereby really impact the end customer, right? And of course, the same of having the value of more secured applications because it's going to be on the cloud, and then it's the static infrastructure itself, you're going to do a lot of saving, right? So with that, I will be handing over to Alfus, who is going to talk more about replatforming. The focus for today's session is on replatforming and not really modernization. So where we are going to talk about how can you really go about doing the replatforming of the apps. Over to you, Alfus. Thank you.
So good evening, everyone. Thanks, Poornima. So replatforming, how do we do? Especially we are focusing on .NET applications here. So we see here like the replatforming process, we categorize them like or divided them into like three phases, discovery and scoping, build and test, and scale and operate. So basically Poornima covered like most of the part from discovery and scoping perspective. Like I will go over in the build phase, go more into technical and see how we can achieve those applications, replatforming of those applications. And then finally, like once we are done with the build and test, we get into the scale and operate mode, which is the end state of the system, where we scale our, tune our applications, and we handle our production readiness, all those, the later things after the build and test. Basically, after delivering our application to production will happen in the third phase. So we identified like 8 key enablers. They are basically out of critical 12 factors. So what are the 12 factors that we basically focus on replatforming? Because there are certain mandatory 12 factors that your application should be applied with those 12 factors so that they can be running in cloud. So the minimum things that we are talking about. And we came up with some strategies and approaches like how we can do the replatforming process for a .NET application. This can also be a generic thing, but in smaller stages. So even if you get stuck somewhere, like it will be a smaller failure, you can turn around and you will get a quick turnaround time doing these processes. The first key enabler that we will focus on is like code base, CI, and delivery. So you have your application in your legacy repository. whatever it is, like take their application down to a new repository and see if your application already has automated integration, regression, test suites, right? If it's already available, then we are lucky. Like we can just go to the next process. If not, identify the breaking points that we have to identify what are the points, what are the integration points that I may break doing the replatforming for this particular application. So identify those and build automated test suites. Why we are doing this? Because we will go over like multiple stages of replatforming, and we cannot rely on like manual testing every time on the application, right? If we build something at the very beginning as a minimum level, then we can leverage that for every stage then where we move on into our stages. That saves a lot of time and effort, everything. Then the next thing like we would suggest is like to upgrade the framework of the application to the latest frameworks. So in .NET, like we may have legacy frameworks like right from 1.1 or 0 through anything. Like we have to upgrade to the latest ones, like at least 4.6 or above, so that we can leverage our standard libraries. Today, all those libraries and APIs are available in .NET standard. So we can leverage them later in time. Like we will see into the session like where we can leverage and things like that. So we can we have to upgrade that to the latest framework. Then obviously, like we have to build the CI pipeline and the delivery pipeline for this application so that we can push the application to cloud, Foundry, and test it out going through the stages. The next thing, next key enabler that we will discuss about is dependencies and making them self-contained. So here we are talking about dependencies like GAC and then registry dependencies and then internal or any kind of like third-party client utilities that we use for the application. For example, any of the database clients that we may use. So usually in our traditional way, in our static infrastructure, what we do, like we have to install our operating systems with all the necessary applications and the drivers and things like that upfront before running our application. For example, you need to have IaaS in your operating system to have a web application running, right? So think about in Cloud Foundry, we are running small containers, and they are like a thin image of operating system, and you won't have anything installed on it. So you have to take everything within your application. So identify those kind of dependencies, bring them to your binary published folder, and modify your application so that it uses that dependencies from there to execute it. So that is the first step like that you have to do. And once you get this done, now your application is ready to push to cloud. Because you have your, you need not any, you, anymore, you need not think about any of the dependencies within the container. So you are now ready to go. Your application is all set. You have everything within the application package. Now you think about creating a manifest. So and then push using the Cloud Foundry command, like cf push. So if you look into the manifest, most likely we deal with either of these two of the build pack that you see in the slide. Either the hostable web core build pack or binary build packs. So in case of console applications and basically like non-web applications, you can go with binary build pack. The build pack, it does nothing. Like it takes whatever you give, part of your binary bin folder, it takes it and hosts it into the cloud and make it run there. But whereas the hostable web core is a thin version or the underlying layer behind the IaaS framework, like you can, like IaaS. So it basically allows an application to run on top of it. So basically, the build pack gives you that runtime capability and takes it part of it. So when you push an application with that build pack, that means your application will be able to run on top of it in cloud. Because you have to think like you don't have IaaS on the containers. The third one we talk about is configuration. So in cloud, think this way, like, configuration should be injected via environment variables. So in our normal development methodology, like what we do, what we practiced before, is like we create a static XML file and inject all the configurations on it, and then you make use of the application to read it from there. But in cloud, when we go to cloud, we cannot do it anymore. Like we have to treat every configuration as environment variables. So for that, we have certain things like Microsoft iConfiguration. You can use that. That's one of the coolest things to use. And we have other option in Cloud Foundry that we can use, like user provider services. Like we can see some samples next, in the next slides. I think you can see that. The first one, the old state using configuration manager. So if you look into the code, you can really see like this is how traditionally we do that. Traditionally, how we get a configuration for a web application from a web.config or a custom configuration file. So simple thing to change is just keep the class, keep the configuration manager or the configuration server as it is, and just make a small code change, like take it from environment, environment.get your value, whatever it is. So that makes you come out of that problem. So you are now out of that problem. And how you are going to make this environment variable with your application in cloud? So for that, you can make use of manifest. So I have put a small screenshot here down, how you can inject your environment variables, part of your manifest to your application. You can also use CF commands to do that, but this is a nicer way to do it, so that application, deployment, configuration, all is available in a manifest sheet. And this is, I'm not going to spend much time on this slide, so this is like the next enhancement piece of it, how you can leverage Steel Toe and make use of Steel Toe's, because Steel Toe give you out of the box, like how you can read the configurations from Cloud Foundry environment. So you can very well use this. I have like two slides here, like explaining how you can work together. One is like how your new state of configuration file looks like. Second one, like you have to just create a configuration model. Like for example, SQL connection string output file, anything environment specific can be brought together externally. And then how your application, so you should have something called like a configuration manager within your application that builds the configuration for the whole application, making use of Steel Toe, Cloud Foundry. The code is like almost complete code, like anyone who is interested can look at it later get the code out of it. And then the only thing is like you have to invoke this manager where you start your application. So basically our web applications, like we start from global ASAX file, everyone knows that. From there, we use like application start event. So that is the place the application starts, will be firing off, and you will get all your configuration in your application so that you can use it anywhere. So this is using Steel Toe. And then one of the factors, consider logs as event stream. So logs are nothing but like application events, right? So we have to treat them as streams. In our olden ways, like we used to write them in files. We have a lot of logging frameworks that we use. We used to write them as files in our application, in some file system or somewhere. But like here, we have to treat everything as like standard out or standard errors. So that is simple to simple to implement. We will show the code snippet as well for that. And then once you implement it. Or like you can use like tools like Splunk, Graylog, whatever you see here, to actually like drain the logs out of Cloud Foundry and do whatever analysis we need. So Cloud Foundry has its firehose which pushes all the streams of events coming out from an application to its console. We can drain it from there using any of these tools. Like it's optional for us to use. And if you see the code snippet here, I have in the left-hand side, I have option one. I am just using a console.error write line and console.out.write line. That's a simple logging. You can replace like all the third-party frameworks and just write a simple logging, which will be good enough for Cloud Foundry. Another hand side, like you have Microsoft extensions logging, which is a package, NuGet package available. You can make use of it, and you will have an abstracted logger that you can implement in your application. And later, if you decide to move to like log format or any seri log or any kind of logging framework, it's very easy to implement, use it for the application using the Microsoft iLogger. You need not do any big code changes in one place. You have to say like, my logging provider is this. So the Microsoft iLogging will provide those kind of benefits to us. And then file streams to object. This is another key enabler. So most of the applications, like we deal with files. We come across this log, this is almost similar to that. We write the files, we read files from like file distributed file systems, right? Or some within the local server or some file location. But here we cannot do that. So our container is going to be stateless, and it can be crashed anytime. So you lose all the files, and it's anti-pattern to write anything, any of this kind of data within the container. It's an anti-pattern, so we should not do that. So what we do, we leverage S3 object storages, like cloud storages, for writing it outside. Or you can also use NoSQL databases like Redis or Mongo, anything like that. You can use it to write any external file system, data to any of the file systems. And this also helps us, helps other applications which are lying outside of Cloud Foundry to access the data from this file. So they can interact, they can like consume the data output from one of the cloud applications. The same way, vice versa, we can use it. And I have put some simple model, code sample as well here. So you can abstract the file handling with a helper. Like you can abstract them, and your system need not know about where it's going to write. It's going to write in a file system, it's going to write in Redis or anywhere. Like it need not know. So abstract, you can create an abstract helper class kind of thing and inject it wherever you need to implement. And you see here I have written like old implementation versus like new implementation. So it's as simple as to change the code like this. Only thing we have to think about how we have to inject that into the required classes. So next one is stateless processes. We already came across this. But a good example like I can bring here is the session. So look at the picture here. We have three users working on an application, and the requests are floating around all the instances of the application. So where will you store your session? So an instance cannot handle the state of the application. It should be stateless. So the good thing about Redis, we have it as a marketplace service. We can leverage that. And then we do have a Microsoft NuGet package available, Redis Session State Provider. There is a link provided here, like you can see, how we can easily implement. I have also put some code samples for how to easily implement it. It's two changes, one in the web.config file, as what you see here. You just have to mention the configuration, what you see here. And you can throw out the connection string of the Redis using, this is the exact little working example. You can take this and use it for any of the .NET applications. So this will help on that. And then think about scalability. So if you have your applications bulky, like 4GB, 5GB of containers, like it's not good for scaling. But you need to have it as thin as possible. So what do you do? In our legacy applications, what we do, like we, to handle, to meet our SLAs or to handle all these things, like what we do, we create concurrency within the application. Like we use multiple threads, right? Child process, work processes, and we keep the application like bulky and heavier. But here, like we need to have our application as thin as possible so that you can scale horizontally. So this picture here will clearly tell you what is horizontal scaling and what is vertical scaling, looking from two perspectives. One is like infrastructure perspective, another one is like an application perspective. So you see in the left-hand side of the picture, you are increasing the size of the servers, and you are increasing the size of the application to deal with like multiple concurrent processes. Whereas in the other side, you are not changing the size of the servers or the size of the application, you are just cloning the application, you are just increasing them horizontally. This clearly tells what is horizontal scaling versus vertical scaling. And so in our legacy application, we may have handling like multiple threads. What do we do there? So do some simple code change to make it single threaded and push it to cloud. And then think about scaling just by increasing the number of instances instead of you dealing with playing around within the code to handle multiple threads. Those are some simple techniques we can use. And we have like app autoscaler available. This is available in PCF as a tile. You can use it so that your application can be scaled based on, I think, CPU, HTTP latency, and HTTP throughput. You can configure a very simple configuration that helps you dynamically scaling your application up and down based on the demand. And last but not the least here, like security. So thinking about security, like Cloud Foundry, it gives you out of the box, checks most of the runtime vulnerabilities, takes care of it, and it gives you like UAA and like single sign-on providers so that you can leverage that for authentication and authorization purposes. If your organization is already using any third-party gateways or identity providers, what we are going to do, so you can look at it, like this is a code sample, like how you can simply make it happen. So you can write your own middleware or HTTP module as what you see in the top figure. Like there, there's a simple way of writing a middleware for a .NET application. You can write it and you can add your authorization and all the implementations where I have put a comment there down. And then add these lines in the web.config. That's it, your story done. So you will have your security. You can make use of it for dealing with replatforming and making use of any of the external security providers. And before going to the end, we have like a couple of case studies, not case studies, like samples, like I can show you like how we came through this journey by all these stages, like all the stages that we were describing before. So I took a simple application here. You see the application at the top. So basically the application, what it does, the user is like submitting something, some request in the web application. And the request goes into, the request will create a trigger file and that lands into a distributed file system share. So there is a window service up there monitoring the file share, looking for the trigger file. Once it receives the trigger file, it starts processing and then lets the user know asynchronously that I'm done with the process. He can go and check the status any time of his process, whatever he requested. So how we are going to do that? So whatever the eight enablers that we came across, we do for the application. Like here, there are two, three applications here. One is a web application and another one like a backing service for that application and another one a Windows service. So how are we going to tackle this situation and make that run in cloud? So we leverage two things here. RabbitMQ as our message broker. So we converted our Windows service, which is monitoring the file system for the file, we converted it to an event-driven service and it will be subscribed to that particular queue. And the backend service you see here as API will publish a message as soon as the user requests it. So immediately the event-driven microservice is going to start processing and do this. So we achieve the same thing, making use of some additional services like RabbitMQ and object storage, and then the replatforming. So this is a simple example how we leverage them. And another one, like little more complex application. So this is a little tricky application. Like we have an application, it runs like a couple of days a month. And but the problem here is we have to run them in like 2 days. And it processes like millions of transactions. We cannot, we don't have time. We cannot run it for like 10 days to get all those millions transactions complete. We have to complete by, our SLA is 2 days. And today, our static infrastructure, we have around like 150 like CPU cores working around that application to process those load within those 2 days. So that is how it is. It was today, it was before the old state of the application. And think about the whole year, 99% of the times like this whole infrastructure is going to be idle. It's not going to be used by anything. It's dedicated for that application. And we have like three or four giant servers of like 150 cores, like they are going to sit idle. And what are you going to do with that? So this will be a good candidate to pick it and run in cloud so that you can make use of pay-as-you-go kind of thing. So what we did, like we faced them, like we had all these phases like discovery and scoping and then come across an MVP zero. We take the most CPU oriented portion of it, like you see like scaled to a larger instance, take that portion, replatformed it, we made them up in cloud. And because they are all console applications, you can see from the picture there, we made use of CF tasks. So Cloud Foundry task is a good thing. Like you can launch your task and it goes away as soon as it's done. It's not a long running process. So we made use of that. So we have to talk to Cloud Foundry to start the task and stop the task. So start the task and it will be all done by itself. So we made that happen just by platforming portion of the application, right? So then that is MVP zero. And the next one we think, okay, then we have a remaining few portion of the application partially outside. So if you look into the picture, like you have a primary server, you have secondary, you have multiple servers use, work together for that application. But in the MVP zero stage, you only rely on one static infrastructure, whereas the remaining all went into cloud. The scale, most scaling, most CPU oriented, most memory oriented, all these are we brought into cloud. And what is the next MVP? Next MVP, we took the remaining portion of the system and we brought it into cloud. So that is as simple, that is not very complicated as what we did in the MVP zero. But still, is it done? No. So we had a limitation in scaling. because our application was like, as I said, our application should be, containers should be as thin as possible when we run in cloud, so that we can granularly scale your application as needed. But we didn't get that in just replatforming. So we couldn't, our each and every instances, container instances were like 4 to 6 gigabytes. So we couldn't, like, even though we have enough infrastructure, we couldn't scale up to that level. So what then we had to, we think about modernization of the first portion that we moved into in MVP 0. We took them, we modernized them. We broke this application into smaller microservices, and we made them all, like you can see, as you see in the queues, they all are like event-driven queues, and we can scale them granularly as much as needed. Like whichever takes, like we can find a ratio between these services, which needs more more power. Like we can just scale them. Now, after our modernization, each and every service like comes to like 256 MB from like 6 gig and 4 gigs. So you have like more rooms to scale, room to scale. So that's when we had to go in this hybrid approach. It's like a phase by phase, MVP 0, 1, 2, now we are done. So, and there are some standard recommendations. I think I took a lot of time. So there are some standard recommendations for .NET developers to make use of steel toe wherever needed. They can make use of Redis atomic functions to if you come across a situation that I need to synchronize between the scaled instances of a particular application, what do you do? So you can simply make use of atomic functions in Redis. There are some two functions available. Make use of it. And then similarly, like we have to think about DP, how data protection is used in .NET applications. So it handles by itself. When you scale your applications, how are you going to manage it? Think about olden days, how we handle web form configuration. It's the same thing, I put a screenshot over there. Just by having that, you can handle that. So it will be given to the framework to just make use of it. And debugging in your local for .NET applications, simply use hwc.exe. It's the hostable web core, which is the same one that platform is using. You can use, make use of it. I think others, like you can go over these slides. And the slides are available in the, I think the shed. You can go download it and see the code in detail. Thank you. Then I will hand over to Poornima for the conclusion.
Yeah, we are almost done. We just quickly had the benefits to the business, right? Because typically, you do the transformation and what it means, right? So what a quick with just the replatforming, we have seen some significant infrastructure savings for the enterprise that we did this work, and even from months it takes to deploy, we were able to do a weekly deploy because we moved from a legacy code to a microservice architecture. And then disaster recovery, right? Any IT firm, like we do a lot of focus on the disaster recovery. By just sheer moving to the cloud infrastructure, we were able to better manage and optimally cost manage on that part. So these are like real quick wins that we can really do if we just start rapidly going into the cloud journey and then just moving ahead. So with that, our session ends, and we hope like it was useful and interesting. Any questions for us, please?
Thank you.